A very good evening to everyone present in Google Meet virtual platform, YouTube stream, and Facebook Live. I take this privilege to warm welcome all of you to the international webinar on wildlife studies and management case studies. Respected Principal CMB College, Dr. Surajit Datta sir, President Zoological Society of Assam, Srijut Priyaboto Lahkar sir, Working President ZSA Dr. Balendra Kumar Das sir, General Secretary ZSA Professor Jugen Chandra Kalita sir, Resource Persons Sudha Balajapalli and Shreya Bhattacharya ma'am, Joint Coordinator Keshav Jyoti Bora, Tracers and Researchers of different universities and colleges of entire India, my colleagues and students from different institutions. I am Bidyut Bikash Shoikia, Coordinator, IQSC CMB College, Bukakhat. CMB College is a premier institute of Bukakhat subdivision. This college has been offering excellent atmosphere for quality education since last 26 years. During these years, the college has engaged itself in process of capacity building, both in terms of infrastructure and human resource development. CMB College has counted tremendous effort in developing it into a well-equipped science institutions, incorporating all elements from contemporary scientific milieu. The international webinar on wildlife studies and management case studies is a collaborative endeavor of CMB College and prestigious organization Zoological Society of Assam. The webinar aims to impact the young generation by drawing their attention towards the need to understand the nature. Wildlife management practices will be the main point of this webinar. Here, wildlife practices will be discussed through different case studies like management and conservation of wildlife in USA. A case study of golden jackal feeding behavior will also be discussed. The session on ecological area and nature conservation are expected to help students and interested youth grasp scientific insights on the nature around us. Now I invite our BSc second semester student, Gauri Shikhar Nath, to launch into the webinar with Saraswati Vandana. And I request all participants to hold their audio mute off. Gauri Shikhar, please present your Saraswati Vandana.
গৌরী, তুমি মিউট হয়ে আসা। গৌরী প্লিজ আনমিউট।
হ্যালো, নমস্কার। ইয়া কুন্দেন্দু তুষার হার ধবলা, ইয়া শুভ্র বস্ত্রাবৃত, ইয়া বীণা বরদন্দ মন্দ্রিত করা, या श्वेत पद्माशना, या ब्रह्माश्रुत शंकरा प्रभृतिवी देवशदा वंदिता, श्यामां पात सरस्वती भगवतीं निशेषजाद्यापहम् शुक्लं ब्रह्म विशारशारपरमा माद्यां जगद्व्यापिनी बिना पुस्तकधारिणी मभयदं जाद्यान्धकरापहम् हस्ते स्वातिकमालिकां विदधति पद्माशनेशं स्थिता वन्दितां परमेश्वरि भगवतीं बुद्धिप्रदां शारदां.
थैंक यू गौरी शिखर. नाउ मे आई रिक्वेस्ट अवर प्रिंसिपल डॉक्टर सुरजित दत्त सर टू वेलकम ऑल ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द ऑर्गेनाइजिंग कमिटी.
थैंक यू विद्युत. A very good evening to all of you. Honorable President of Zoological Society of Assam, Sri Priyabrata Lohkar sir, Honorable Working President, ZSA, Dr. Bolendra Kumar Das sir, Honorable Head of the Department, Department of Zoology, Guwahati University, and General Secretary, ZSA, Professor Jugen Chandra Kolita sir, respected resource person, Sudha Balajapalle, and Shreya Bhattacharya, respected faculty members from different colleges and universities, research scholars, undergraduate and postgraduate student participants, and my dear colleagues. Today, we are organizing this international webinar on wildlife studies and management case studies in collaboration with Zoological Society of Assam. On behalf of CNB College fraternity, I take this opportunity to thank and express our gratitude to Professor Jugen Chandra Kolita sir for his constant guidance and valuable suggestions to organize such a webinar. We are also thankful to Dr. Bolendra Kumar Das sir for inspiring us and always encouraging to do something better. I expect this webinar would enlighten all of us present here on the current development of wildlife management and importance of preservation of biodiversity. It is a glorious moment to extend my warm wishes on behalf of the CNB College Bukakhat and take the prospect to share a few words about our institution. CNB College Bukakhat has been a center of excellence in pertaining science education and trained and inculcated the scientific temperament to the ignited minds for last 26 glorious years. We never miss any opportunity and always do our best to provide feeder to fly high in the sky to our students. And this international webinar is also a part of it. As we know that in this present lockdown situation for COVID-19 pandemic, education system is adversely affected, and to compensate this, we are trying our best to provide online classes as well as conducting national as well as international webinars, lectures, seminars, etc. I feel honored to welcome all of you for taking a keen part in this important program, and I am sure that you all will feel enriched with knowledge after completion of this event. With these few words, I welcome you all once again to the webinar and hope that you all will have a great time ahead. Thank you all. Vidya.
Thank you, Principal sir, for your valuable welcome speech. Today, we are very lucky to have with us the man behind this webinar, the most dynamic teacher, researcher, and organizer of Assam, the advisor of IQSC CNB College, General Secretary of ZSA, ex-director of College Development Council, Guwahati University, ex-director in charge, UGC-HRDC, Guwahati University, present head of the Department of Zoology, Guwahati University, the Commonwealth Scholar, Professor Jugen Chandra Kolita sir. I request Kolita sir to inaugurate today's webinar.
Kolita sir. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Bidyut Bikash Shoikia, Honorable Principal, respected president of JJSA, working president of JJSA, esteemed speaker, two very young speakers, those who are here with us this evening, esteemed faculty members of CNB College, Professor Hilaljyoti Sinha from Boroland University, and maybe, I am not sure, but Parthankar Chowdhury. Professor Parthankar will be joining from Assam University, Silchar, and his many students. And I can see here that now esteemed participant friends are there, more than 215 in our Google Meet, and many in our Facebook and YouTube streaming. Why all these people are getting together? Why we are united? It is because of the very important cause, which has been narrated by Honorable Principal already. Our biodiversity is very important. Our planet Earth, the nature, is very precious. And if our young minds, they are working for the betterment of our nature, conservation, preservation strategies, they can develop, and our future will be better. As all of you know, ideas and the resources, mainly the human resources, are very important today. And all good ideas are within you, my dear young friends, the students. You are the future. My esteemed research scholars and my dear students and faculty members, when Dr. Surajit Dutta, myself, and esteemed faculty member of CNB College, we discuss many issues regarding college development, human resource development. Normally, we discuss about graduate quality, how to make better graduates from our colleges. As you could see, Gauri was singing that prayer in the beginning of the meeting. Our students from CNB College, they are versatile. When I see them in many international conferences, they could ask questions. And many a time we find that even students cannot ask questions. But CNB College, I can say you with guarantee that today there will be many questions from them, because their inquisitiveness is more. Why? Because of the dynamic teachers. And I am sure that many scholars from Dibrugarh University, Guwahati University, Portland University, even from IITs and many institutions, they are joining today. Why? Because two young girls, they will talk. What they will talk? They will talk about our future. And they will talk, they will say that mindset is important. So therefore, develop a mindset and know what you have. You see Sudha, she joined Guwahati University at a very devastating time, but she was not taking rest. She was telling to her guide, Professor Prashant Kumar Shaikya, biodiversity international expert, that I want to get out of Guwahati University guest house, want to go to Kaziranga National Park, Manas National Park. At that point, Prashant told me what to do. Then Sudha talked to me. She said, sir, I need to go to the national park and I will go. Then I talked to her that please wait, because pandemic is there, there may be problem. But you, my dear friends, you know, where there is the will, there is the way. She could find out the top level officers of Assam, Forest Department, and got permission from ministry, and she visited many of the villages where she was supposed to go. So today she will talk all these things. And Shreya, Parthankar Chowdhury, she referred to Parthankar Chowdhury, that Kolita sir, Dr. Parthankar Chowdhury talk about you, and he said that I should know you and give me blessings. I said, what you do? She said, I was doing work in Hungary, completed my work, some of the work, and most of the work I have been in my planning. Then I immediately said, can you deliver a lecture so that our student can learn from you? She said, yes, why not? As I have already informally said in the beginning, these two girls, okay, they are so positive. Positive energy they have more than 100%. So if our student from Assam can get at least 0.01% from both of them, I think our future will be the best future in the world. So therefore, without any delay, I am offering my blessings to both the speakers, and I congratulate the entire faculty and authorities of CNB College, because they are also full of positivity. When I said, can you do that? Immediately all of them, okay? A to Z, they are science college. So they are all faculties are scientifically oriented. So immediately they say yes. And that yes is happening today. So I formally inaugurate this with the wish that this CNB College will be holding a position in the great academic map of the world. And Sudha and Shreya will bring their messages from CNB College to the platform of the world. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kolita sir, for your precious and encouraging words. Now it is the time to hand over the platform to our honorable research persons. So without any further delay, I would like to request Keshav Jyoti Bora, research scholar of Guwahati University, active member of ZSA, alumni of CNB College Bukakhat, and joint coordinator of today's webinar to introduce our research persons and to moderate the interactive session. Thank you. Thank you,
Keshav. Thank you, sir. A very good evening to one and all present here. It's my honor and great privilege to introduce before you an eminent scholar, Ms. Sudha Balajipalli, who is pursuing her PhD from George Mason University of Fairfax, USA, in environmental science and public policy. Looking back to her journey, she received her bachelor degree in biology in 2012 and master's degree in environmental science and policy in 2015 from George Mason University, Fairfax, USA. She is presently serving as an adjunct professor in the same university now. She worked as a researcher in US Fish and Wildlife Service, Ecological Services, lifting team, Falls Church in USA from April to August 2020. She had been a graduate intern in US Fish and Wildlife Service, Division of International Conservation, Rhino and Tiger Conservation Fund, Falls Church, USA, from June 2015 to April 2019. She served as a graduate intern in the branch of Foreign Species, Falls Church, USA, from 2013 to June 2015. She also served as a graduate teaching assistant in George Mason University from August 2015 and May 2016. She holds the life membership of Graduate Students Association of George Mason University and Society of Conservation Biology since 2013 and 2021, respectively. Presently, she is conducting her research works in various national parks of Assam for partial fulfillment of her PhD degree here. We welcome you wholeheartedly, and we are indeed lucky to have you amongst us today. Another short announcement for the participants now. During the presentation, participants are requested to put their queries for the resource person in the chat box, which will be picked up during the interactive session. Now, may I request Ms. Sudha to continue the program with your presentation. Over to you, Sudha.
Okay, hello, can everybody hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yes, okay. I will start sharing my presentation.
Sure.
Good evening, respected faculty and colleagues. My name is Sudha Balajipalli. And Keshav, thank you so much for that lovely lovely introduction. I really appreciate it. And JC Kesar for that wonderful kind words you have shared with me. So today I'm going to talk to you about conservation strategies from United States of America. And let's continue. Okay. So this is the lecture outline I will follow. I'll talk about the definition of wildlife management, a brief history of wildlife management in the US. Then I will talk about two case studies in depth from US. Then I'll talk about Project Tiger and TCA and Global Tiger Recovery Program. So Decker et al. In 2001 defines wildlife management as the management process influencing interactions among and between wildlife, its habitats, and people to achieve predefined impacts. So in the image on your right, you will see management environment. And within the management environment, you will see wildlife, habitats, and humans. And they're all interacting with each other, and they're also influencing each other. And this is wildlife management triad. This is what we use in the US to do wildlife management. So a history of wildlife management in the US started in 1920 and 1930 by Aldo Leopold. And that is the gentleman you see on your left with the pipe. So, and his close associate, Herbert Schubert. So both of them were trained in scientific forestry at the Yale School of Forestry, which argued that modern science and technology could be used to restore and improve wildlife habitat. In 1930, Leopold wrote Game Management. This was the first book on wildlife management in US. And then he proceeded to write another book called A Sand County Almanac, which argued land ethics. So as per Leopold, he argued that land ethics is a responsible relationship existing between people and the land they inhabit. So this was groundbreaking at the time because it was 1949. And his view of land ethics was really remarkable. And every conservation biologist in the US has read the Sand County Almanac, and I too have a copy and have read it. So I encourage my Indian colleagues to also read this book. You can purchase this on Amazon. So in India, you have national parks and wildlife sanctuaries. In US, we have national parks and national wildlife reserves, reserve systems. So wildlife reserve systems are equivalent to wildlife sanctuaries. So our wildlife reserves were established in 1903, and the founders were Paul Krugel, who's a naturalist, and President Theodore Roosevelt. So the National Wildlife Reserves encompass 607,000 square kilometers, and also their governing agency is the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. And the mission statement is to administer a national network of land and waters for the conservation, management, and where appropriate restoration of fish, wildlife, and plant resources and their habitats within the U.S. for the benefit of the present and future generations of Americans. So Fish and Wildlife has a huge department called refugees, wildlife refugees. In D.C., where I was located, we do mostly policy work. But, however, the real action takes place in the states, and that is where all the management, wildlife management, and conservation is taking place. So the states is where all the action is. So this map is actually fantastic. It shows you all the national wildlife refugees from 1940 to 2030. And the wildlife refugees encompass wetlands, prairies, coastal areas, marine areas, temperate forests, which are found on the East Coast, where I'm from, tundra and boreal forests, which are found on the West Coast and in Alaska. So some of the objectives and responsibilities of national wildlife refuges include monitoring plants and animal populations, restoring wildlife, wetlands, forests, grasslands, and marine habitats, controlling the spread of invasive species, reintroducing fish, wildlife and plants to their original habitats, monitoring air quality, investigating contaminants, preventing and controlling wildlife diseases, assessing water quality and quantity, understanding also working with local communities, managing habitats and like prescribed burning and timber harvest. So the picture on your right is showing you Canute National Wildlife Reserve in Alaska. And this was developed in 1980. Canute is a Native American word, and I hope I'm pronouncing that correct. So if you look at the side-by-side comparison of national wildlife refuges versus wildlife sanctuaries here in India, you can see that they're pretty similar. They're both protective habitats for endangered species. They're both created under law. Our law is the Endangered Species Act or Marine Mammal Protection Act. Here it's the Wildlife Protection Act. They're managed by government agencies. Ours is the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. Here it's the Ministry of Environment, Forest, and Climate Change. They both have some scientific research conducted, and they're both working with local communities. So you can see national wildlife refuges are pretty similar to wildlife sanctuaries here in the U.S., in India. This is the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge. You can see on the image on the right that it is in Alaska, and it is right above Fairbanks, which is a very populated city. And it was established in 1960, and there's 78,000 square miles of area, and its habitat is coastal tundra and mountains and coastal lagoons, salt marshes, and most of the wildlife are mammals, migratory birds, and marine mammals. And it is home to the polar bear, and the polar bear is a marine mammal. So a little bit biology about the polar bear. Polar bear is dependent on sea ice, which forms above open waters. The diet includes seals. And the polar bear is pretty big. It's about 800 to 1600 kg and 4 to 6 meters. Reproductive biology is 1 to 2 cubs per litter. And the gestation process is pretty long. So you can see from the image on the right, you see the trends in polar bear subpopulations. And you can see the polar bear is in the Arctic, near the Arctic Circle. So the countries that the polar bear is in is U.S., in Alaska, Canada, Greenland, and Russia. So those are the range countries. So you can see that the blue circles are the stable populations of polar bears. And the yellow is the increasing populations, while the red is decreasing and in need of further assistance. And also, there's also gray, where the data is deficient. And this is the biggest reason why data is deficient in these areas is because it is extremely cold in these areas and very difficult for us to do census work here. So the major threats to polar bears is climate change. And I talked a little bit about this in my previous lecture. There's also loss of denning habitat. And third is human activity. So when we do wildlife management in the U.S., we have a recovery plan. And the recovery plan is there to address threats first and foremost. So the major threat to polar bears is climate change. So we have the Circumpolar Action Plan, which is a 10-year plan for all the range countries like the U.S., Canada, Russia, and Greenland. And this works towards conserving polar bears. So this is an international wildlife agreement that all the countries signed. And the major objective is to reduce greenhouse gases, so CO2 emissions. So greenhouse gases have a negative impact on the polar ice caps because they're causing temperatures to be increased, and then the ice is melting. So the polar bears have no ice sheets to walk on, and they're in dire strait. Also, the second objective is to protect them legally in nations. So we have the Endangered Species Act, and because the polar bear is a marine mammal, it's also protected under the Marine Mammal Protection Act in the U.S. Also, we wanted to curb illegal trade, and that is through CITES, the convention. So this is also an international convention that I spoke about in my previous slide, in my previous lecture. So a lot of hunting is done poaching is done for polar bears. So CITES is a way to trade illegal parts. So CITES is a regulation to stop trade in endangered species. So there was also a way to curb illegal trade in polar bears. The second thing is that there was a loss of denning habitat regarding polar bears. So denning is the process by which pregnant mothers dig a large hole to create a den in which she gives birth and then comes out after 3 months. During this time, the mother survives using reserve fats in the body. So denning is actually very important for the polar bear in order to reproduce. So if there are not sufficient denning habitats, the polar bear will not give birth, and hence population collapse. So yeah, the U.S. has identified many denning sites using LIDAR technology. And we have shared this technology, with our range partners. So the Arctic National Wildlife Reserve that I spoke about previously is a great denning site habitat. So the third major threat to polar bears is human activity. So the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service works in concert with private partners as it relates to tourism, recreation, oil, gas, development, mining, and shipping to mitigate some of these impacts so that polar bears can have a free reign of the range and also reproduce. So the recovery plans not only address the threats that a species face, but the recovery plans also address additional things that the population needs in order to have a sustainable population. So number four would be population estimates. So regular population estimates and monitoring is required with all endangered species. So this is what we're seeing in the recovery plan. So we can see the trends in population sizes, see if they're decreasing or increasing, and then adjust our recovery plan according to these trends. And also, the polar bear has a cultural traditional value to the Native Americans in Alaska and Canada. So we have to be sensitive about their cultures, and we have to maintain their cultures and traditions while also maintaining polar bear populations. So the Fish and Wildlife also works with native populations in order to mitigate any conflict and also to help them understand and aware of like polar bear conservation. So currently there are 20 to 25,000 polar bears. So the next case study is the Florida Panther. And we go, and Florida Panther National Wildlife Reserve. So Florida Panther National Wildlife Reserve was established in 1986. The habitat is a mix of dry upland habitat and wetland, including pine rocklands and tropical hardwood hemlocks. The area is 107 square kilometers, and it includes animals, birds, fish, and mammals. And it is home to the Florida Panther. A little bit biology about the Florida panther. The Florida panther is actually a subspecies, and the genus is a puma. So the Florida panther, if you look at the image on the right, you can see the historical range, which is in green, and then the current range, which is in red. So the historical range stretches from Arkansas, Louisiana, to South Carolina, all the way down to Florida. Now it is isolated to only southern Florida. So we have, so it's only isolated to 5% of its historical range. So the Florida panther habitat is pine lands, tropical hardwood, hemlocks. Its diet is usually white-tailed deer, and white-tailed deer are pretty abundant in United States, especially on the East Coast, and also small prey such as the hispid hare. So the weight and the length of the Florida panther is a little bit smaller than the leopards you have here. So they're classified as medium cats, but they are smaller than the leopards here. And the reproduction is pretty much similar to most cats, 1 to 3 litter sizes and 92 to 96 gestation days. So the threats to the Florida panther include habitat destruction, genetic depletion due to interbreeding, and vehicle collisions. Yes, vehicle collisions, because America is the nation of highways, and all of us like to drive everywhere. So vehicle collisions are pretty predominant when it comes to Florida panther deaths. So the Florida panther recovery plan must address all these threats. Right. So the first thing is that the Fish and Wildlife created critical habitat for the Florida panther. and that includes the Florida Panther National Wildlife Refuge that I just discussed. This is the current breeding range habitat. Second was the Everglades Headwater National Wildlife Reserve, and that's in south central Florida, and its habitat is for population expansion. Third is the Okefenokee National Wildlife Reserve, and then the Felistenshoh National Wildlife Reserve. One of them is a Native American word, so I probably mispronounced it, so please excuse me. So these two wildlife reserves encompass the historical range of the Florida panther. So the image on the left is showing you Florida panther kittens. So the kittens have these spots on them when they're born. They actually lose the spots as adults. So this is a kind of an interesting feature of the Florida panther. Second, we have to address is the genetic depletion via interbreeding, right? So between 1991 and 94, there were several workshops that was held. And experts from the fields of genetics, conservation biology, captive breeding, and panther biology participated. And they came up with a recovery plan. So what they said was that they took 8 female Texas pumas from Texas, and then they relocated them to Florida Panther Wildlife Reserve. And then the Texas pumas were the closest extinct puma population to Florida. The intent of this plan was to mimic genetic flow that historically occurred between these two subspecies. 5 of the 8 Texas puma produced a total of at least 20 kittens. So the recovery plan was to have at least 3 habitats of 240 individuals. We have not yet reached this goal, but we are on our way. And the third threat to Florida panthers is vehicle collision. And there are many awareness campaigns done by the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission. And this helps reduce the human-wildlife conflict as well as motor accidents. And there's also a hotline that you can call to report any accidents or to learn about panthers in general. So currently there are 120 to 230 panthers in Florida, in U.S. So the image on the left is showing you a Florida panther crossing. This actually reminds me of your boards here near the parks, which are like the elephant corridor signs. So we have this Florida panther signs, which is equivalent. So not only does the recovery plan stop there, but Fish and Wildlife and state conservation organizations have encouraged partnerships, research, and projects. So you can see that there are organizations and partnerships that have developed to save the Florida panther. You can see that there's some zoos that are involved, some research organizations like universities, University of Georgia and University of Florida, also government agencies like the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission, so an NGO such as Defenders of Wildlife. So all of these organizations are trying to save the Florida panther. And there are also projects. So you can see that there are interagency panther response. This is only for government response plan. And also there are South Florida deer research projects. Then there's payment for ecosystem services project. Also there's providing technical assistance and Naples Zoo. Naples Zoo is actually taking in orphaned panthers or abandoned panthers and trying to rehabilitate them and release them back into the wild. So these are some of the projects that the recovery plan supports. So this concludes my case studies regarding U.S. So let's just jump to tiger populations and global tiger populations. We will talk about India and global tiger recovery program in general. So at the end of the 19th century, there were 10,000 wild tigers in the world globally. And the historical range stretched from Siberia all the way to the Asia Minor. And today, the current range is 7%. You can see in the image on the right, you can see pockets of green, and these are highly distributed, fragmented pockets of green throughout South and Southeast Asia. So this includes 7% of the tiger range. So globally, there are 3,890 wild tigers globally, but India has 2,967. And I'm proud to say that India is a stronghold for tigers. So historically, there have been 9 subspecies of wild tigers. The Bengal tiger, which is found in India, Bangladesh, and Nepal, and I believe Bhutan. The Indochina tiger, which is found in Vietnam, Cambodia, and Myanmar, Sumatran, Javan, and Bali tigers are found in Indonesia. Siberian tiger, obviously, is from Russia. Malayan tigers, Malaysia. South China tiger in China. So the Caspian tiger is in Asia Minor, near Turkey and that area. So 3 of the 9 subspecies went extinct, the Bali, Caspian, Javan. And the South China tiger has not been observed in the wild within the last decade. So only 6 tigers now remain, 6 subspecies of tigers remain. So all of the subspecies are listed as Appendix 1 listed species under CITES, and they are threatened due to trade. And India has scheduled the tiger as a Schedule 1 listed species. So a little bit about biology of the tiger. The habitat is rainforest, grasslands, savannas, even mangrove swamps. Its diet includes large-bodied animals like deer. And then its weight is 325 kgs, and it's 2 to 4 meters. Reproduction is pretty standard, 2 to 4 cubs and 103 days of gestation. So the tiger is a pretty big animal. And the threats to tigers include habitat loss, human-tiger conflict, poaching of tigers, prey, or both, because prey and tiger populations are highly correlated. So, and also illegal trade. So if I was talking to an American audience, I would dazzle them with the history of Project Tiger and all of its nuances. However, for an Indian audience, I won't waste your time about all the history of Project Tiger because you guys probably know better about Project Tiger than I do. So I will just say that Project Tiger was enacted in 1973, and it's a centrally sponsored scheme. And the main things are constituted as the core and buffer strategy, which is quite fascinating and pretty remarkable at the time it was envisioned. And also there's the methodology in which to count tigers as individuals is also fascinating and a long journey. So I believe that is as much as I'll say without embarrassing myself too much about Project Tiger. So the National Tiger Conservation Authority, it oversees Project Tiger, and it provides a stationary authority to Project Tiger. It fosters accountability for central state in managing tiger reserves. So, and it also provides oversight by Parliament, and it addresses livelihood issues in tiger reserves. So we don't have something like the National Tiger Conservation Authority in U.S. All animals are treated pretty much the same. So we don't have a gray wolf conservation authority. We pretty much so this is pretty unique to India, and it's a good thing in a way. So if you do a side-by-side comparison of the national wildlife refuges and tiger reserves, you will see that they are pretty similar. They both protect habitat for endangered species. And I can tell you that just because it's a tiger reserve doesn't mean that only tigers live in that reserve. So you know more than me about all the animals and the species that live in the tiger reserves. So So, and also both wildlife refuges and tiger reserves are created by law. Ours is the Endangered Species Act and Marine Mammal Protection Act. Here it's the Wildlife Protection Act. And the governing agency is always going to be U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service because they have jurisdiction over wildlife and fresh waters. And here the jurisdiction for tiger reserves is NTCA. So both are doing scientific research. And an interesting fact about tiger reserves is that more people live in and around tiger reserves, in tiger conservation landscapes, than in Amazon or Congo. So India is pretty unique when it comes to tiger reserves. So let's take a step back, a step forward, and talk about global tiger recovery program. So we were talking about domestic recovery programs and wildlife management. However, there's also international wildlife recovery programs, and one such program is the Global Tiger Recovery Program. So the objective of this Global Tiger Recovery Program is to seek to empower tiger range countries to address the entire spectrum of threats, domestic as well as those that are transboundary in nature, and work towards increasing financial sustainability through the integration of conservation objectives into development. So the goal actually was to double the tiger population, global tiger population, by 2022, which is next year. And so some of the tiger range countries are 13 countries, right? India, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Cambodia, China, Indonesia, Laos, Malaysia, Myanmar, Nepal, Russia, Thailand, and Vietnam. So all these countries, the representatives from all these countries came together in St. Petersburg, Russia, and signed this accord in 2010. And this is actually a World Bank project, and the headquarters is in Washington, D.C. The guys who run this program are Russian, and they're very nice. They actually helped me with my master's thesis. So these people are running the program right out of Washington, D.C. So the GTRP has international goals for all of its signatory bodies. So all 13 countries have agreed to these goals. So they came together and they agreed to these goals. So some of the goals include effectively managing, preserving, protecting, and enhancing tiger habitats, eradicating poaching, smuggling, and illegal trade of tigers, cooperate in transboundary landscape management and in combating illegal trade, engage with indigenous and local communities, increase the effectiveness of tiger habitat management, and restore tigers to their former range. So the logo was actually T times two. So that was the logo, and they wanted to double the tiger population by 2022. When it first came out, all the scientists were baffled because some of the tiger range countries didn't have any tigers. So this is actually quite common in international policy. When there is a very ambitious goal, can everybody mute their microphones, please? Everybody mute their microphones? Thank you. So this is actually quite common in international policy, where you have a very ambitious role, and then all the range countries are quickly adapting to reach that goal. So you have the international goals for all countries, all the range countries, but then you also have individual goals for each country, all the range countries, so individual countries. So GTRP India goals include securing habitats and improving management. So this is like creating new tiger reserves or new tiger habitats, reducing human-tiger conflict, improving habitat management, and research and method activities, and supporting patrol staff. The second goal is to control prey and tiger poaching, establishing a delegated tiger protection force for anti-poaching operations in tiger reserves. So here in Kaziranga, you have a rhino protection force instead of a tiger protection force, which does the same thing, actually. So the tiger protection force actually protects tigers and rhinos. So in Maharashtra, you will have a tiger protection force. But here in Assam, you have a rhino protection force because the rhinos are pretty popular here in Assam. So these two protection forces do the same, pretty much the same thing. They're like additional anti-poaching support staff. You can think of them like that. So the third is to engage community and development. So addressing human-wildlife conflict, testing new landscape-based approaches. Basically, in Assam, you have the eco-development committees. The Forest Department has this, and it is trying to help people find alternative livelihoods and not depend on the forest so much. So these are kind of the same thing, same goals that that the GTRP is promoting. So the fourth goal is to institutionalize strengthening capacity building. What that basically means that you are improving scientific knowledge. So India is a forerunner when it comes to scientific knowledge in tigers. In that, I mean census, in census data, in collecting census and doing census, monitoring tigers and finding out their populations. So India is doing that and they want to improve on this. So WII is, and in conjunction with NTCA, they're always finding new ways to estimate tigers the most accurate way possible. So from 2006 to 2018, you can see that the tiger population did double in 12 years. So India has successfully reached the GTRP goal of doubling its tiger population number. However, if you look at the international counts, you will see a different picture. These numbers are from 2014. So these are a little bit older because not all range countries do tiger census as frequently as India does or Nepal does. So you can see India, even in 2014, was the front runner when it came to tigers. Then Russia, Indonesia, Malaysia, Nepal. Nepal is doing also a fantastic job of producing tigers or increasing its tiger population. However, Nepal, in comparison to India, does not have the habitat. It's a small country, right? So technically they are limited by their habitat. Their tiger populations are limited by their habitat, but India is a pretty big country and can have more tigers. So Thailand also 189. So Bangladesh is a really interesting story. So Bangladesh, before they were doing the census, so some of these range countries, they had to start from square one. In that, I mean, they did not even have a correct census. So they didn't have baseline information regarding tigers. So Bangladesh is such example. They were relying on these old techniques called pugmark techniques. I'm sure you are familiar with it because India at one time was using pugmark techniques too. And recently in 2014, they have switched over to camera tracking techniques in the Sundarbans. So they were pretty shocked that they had only 106. They were expecting 400 or more tigers, and they only got 106. So you can really see that doing scientifically proven techniques to count tigers or any species is really important because then you get an accurate picture or a baseline of where you need to start. So the Bangladeshis were pretty shocked by this number. And so it was a pretty shocking thing in the global tiger community as well. Most scientists expected this, but not the government. So I think it was a bit of a shock for them. Bhutan is 103. Obviously, it's doing well. And China, Vietnam, and Laos, there is no camera trap evidence showing that they even have this much population. These are government numbers, obviously, but these numbers are highly suspect or dubious because we don't have evidence to support this. As a scientist, you need evidence, right? So there is lacking of evidence. And also, Cambodia has zero, and that doesn't mean that there is no tigers in Cambodia. Actually, there was a paper out recently, a couple of years ago, that is showing that Cambodian tiger population is functionally extinct. So they have tigers, but they cannot reproduce anymore. So so they don't have anything in the wild. So Cambodia is in pretty bad shape. So you can see that India is doing the best out of all of them. India, Nepal, Bhutan, perhaps, is doing well out of all the range countries. So thank you for this opportunity to present my presentation. And here are my references.
Excellent. Very nice.
Yeah. That was very good. Thank you so much, Ms. Sudha, for such a wonderful and captivating presentation. We are sure the young participants now have got management practices and more clarity into the topic you are talking about. So, with due permission from you, may we now move on to the interactive section, please?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, can we do the interactive session together? Let's say our present. Then we'll do it.
Yes. Sure, we can. Okay, so we will be doing the interactive session together from both the speakers. So now, let us move forward to the next agenda. Now, moving on towards the next part of our program, we have amidst us another wildlife enthusiast and researcher, Ms. Shreya Bhattacharya from Kolkata. She completed her schooling in ICSE board in 2010 and her higher secondary education from CBSE in 2012. She graduated with honors in electronic science from prestigious Calcutta University in 2016. She joined the St. István University in Hungary and graduated in wildlife conservation and management in 2020. Her research experiences include a self-developed study of water monitor lizard conducted in West Bengal from 2015 to 2016. She again worked as a student researcher in the fishing cat working group and studied details about the various aspects of the animal. She had been involved with the IUCN SSC Monitor Lizard Special Group since 2018. I'm so sorry. She has also completed an internship at the Hungarian Meadow Viper Project in Hungarian Ornithological and Nature Conservation Society during 2020. Her research recent was conducted in the Department of Wildlife Biology, Institute for Conservation of Natural Resources in St. István University of Hungary, which included analysis of the diet of golden jackal. She has been awarded various scholarships and grants, which includes German Academic Exchange Service Scholarship 2016, grant from the Zoological Society for the Conservation of Species and Population, Germany, and the Stipendium Hungaricum Scholarship from 2018 to 2021, very recently. She has published about 4 research papers in very high impact factor journals. Ma'am, we are lucky to have you amongst us today. Again, the same announcement for all the participants. You can drop your questions in the chat box. We'll be picking that up in the interactive session. May I now request Ms. Shreya, ma'am, to continue the program with your presentation. Over to you, ma'am.
Sir, we are not hearing. Have you heard any new question?
Sir, am I audible? Yes, you are audible.
Am I audible?
Yes, sure. Yes, okay. Ma'am.
Yes, okay. Yes. Ma'am.
Okay, so I would like to start with thanking Keshav for such a good, such a nice introduction. I would like to thank Jogan sir for inviting me today among all of you, which is a big pleasure for me. Also, I would like to thank Parthankar sir for introducing me to Jogan sir, and my respect to all the participants here and the colleagues. So with that, I'll start my presentation. Just a second. Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yeah, it is coming, yeah. Shreya.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
It's okay.
Okay. Can you see the presentation?
Yes. Yes, madam.
Okay. So I'll start with my presentation. So the topic of my presentation is about the feeding analysis of golden jackals in Hungary. So this was my bachelor thesis.
back in Hungary for the past 3.5 years where I worked there. So first of all, I would like to introduce you to the species. I'm so sure that all of you are very well aware of the golden jackals, which is commonly found in several parts of India. So I'll come to the ecological part of very medium-sized opportunistic mesocarnivore. Mesocarnivore, the term means that this species is not exactly a carnivore, but depends on predation. So that is the reason why it's known as mesocarnivore. And this species is known to inhabit in several parts of the world, starting and in diverse habitats, starting from deserts to marshlands to tropical evergreen forests, and in several landscapes such as in urban and rural areas. I'm very sure that all of you must have seen a jackal in the nearby areas, whether that's in villages or sometimes in urban areas as well. For example, in Kolkata, in the Taliganj Club, anybody can spot a jackal. So near the Taliganj Club, there's a park where it's very easily spotted. So the jackal is a very opportunistic and generalist predator. By the term opportunistic, I mean that the species can survive. It can survive on a variety of food sources, and it has a high adaptability of any kind of food sources. And they're very generalist predator. That means they don't have a particular kind of specialty, which is called those predators which have a kind of special preference towards prey. That those are called specialist predators. But the jackal is rather a most generalist predator. And they're known to feed on diverse food sources, starting from mammals, small mammals, to fruits, to birds, to seeds, and human leftovers as well, which are found from the anthropogenic sources. So this might be a bit surprising to find that the jackal consumes plant sources, such as seeds and fruits, which were found later on with this study. So now coming to the part of the presentation where I would like to talk about the background of wildlife management in Hungary. So as previously my colleague explained about the wildlife management concept of US, Hungary follows a similar kind of wildlife management where hunting is practiced to control the species population. So that way, golden jackal population is controlled in Hungary through hunting. And around 20th century, the species was suddenly disappeared. The species disappeared from the Hungarian parts of Europe, and it was considered as extinct in the Hungarian Red Book data. So that was a very surprising fact for all the conservationists and wildlife managers, because previously the species were known to exist in Hungary and other parts of Europe since a long time. So after that, in 20th century, suddenly again the species started adapting to several parts of Europe, and that also included Hungary, and then the population basically exploded. So the population increased rapidly, and the home range extended through all of the Hungary and parts of Europe. So as I have already said, that Europe follows similar kind of management like US. Hence, it is a big threat to the wildlife managers to control the population. Hence, there were sudden conflicts that arose between several stakeholders. For example, the game managers, the poultry, the livestock farmers, the wildlife managers, and conservationists as well. So then there were several studies that came up about studying the ecology of this species, because it was very unknown to the conservationists and also to the biologists that how the species all of a sudden started to expand its range and interact with several species in an ecosystem where it was not there for a century almost. So that was a big question and part of interest as well. So that led me to this study, and the hypothesis of this study was that the main primary sources of food items for the jackals are small rodents or small mammals. Okay, so another important thing which I would like to mention here, that the game managers in Hungary, there are four main game species. So the game species can sound a bit not so familiar with all of you. game species are those kind of species which are hunted, which are managed by the game managers. And through that, through the hunting process of the game species, a lump sum amount of money can be derived from several parts of the world to the wildlife sector. And that is basically used to manage and conserve the other species in an area. So it was a big threat. So suddenly the stakeholders, the game managers, suddenly they thought that the jackals are causing a huge damage to this kind of game species. And what are the game species that are found in Hungary? There are majorly four kind of game species, the red deer, the roe deer, the fallow deer, and the wild boar. So these are the four main big game species from which the huge amount of money comes to the wildlife sector of Hungary. And hence, any damage caused to this species can cause a huge loss to the money that can be achieved. So now coming to the hypothesis, as I've already said, that there were from the previous studies of Lansky and Heltai 2002 and Lansky et al. 2015. He was my supervisor, and Lansky is one of the first professors who started the stomach analysis in Europe. At the beginning, and I have worked with both of them in their lab and have learned extensively from them. So I would like to talk about some of the goals and objectives of this study. So the first goal was to obtain a very comprehensive knowledge about the overall food items of the golden jackals. The second one is to obtain the seasonal, like how the diet ecology or the diet preferences changed from several seasons, and also based on the diet, on the gender diet preferences. The gender diet is a very important factor because during the mating season, the diet preferences change. During the pup rearing seasons, the diet preferences change. Hence, it also affects the ecology of a particular habitat. And the third one is to obtain knowledge about the consumption of big game species, which is actually a big conflict in Hungary and also in several parts of Europe. The fourth one is to obtain knowledge about the carrion consumption or the scavenging behavior of the golden jackals. I think this is one of the very important part of my study. That is because several times there is a common notion that the jackals feed on wild boar or maybe deer species. But in reality, those are not through predations, but through scavenging. Like for example, a hunter killed a roe deer or a red deer, or maybe some other predators killed it and then they left it there. So the jackal went there and ate. So that's how those species, those remains were found from the jackal stomach. And hence, there can be a conclusion regarding that. I'm sorry, there's some disturbance. Yeah, thank you so much. So now coming to the material and methods of the study. So the 40 stomach samples were collected from all over Hungary. You can see the graph. The red spots denote the exact areas where these stomachs were collected. And as you can see that the collection points varied throughout the country. And so there were no exact specified places from where they were collected. So, and also there's these stomachs were collected over an interval of around 10 to 12 years. That means there's a high spatiotemporal variation of the data with which this stomach analysis has been done. And another important part which I would like to mention here is that the stomachs which are collected near the water bodies specifically, like the first near the left-hand side, you can see that there's a lake. And beside that, there's a red spot. And from there, that's this Lake Valence. And from there, the stomach content, it constitutes a very diverse kind of food items, which I'll come to it later on. So now coming to the part of the stomach content analysis, which might sound a bit unfamiliar because generally in India, we do not do stomach content analysis as we have hunting rules. We don't have hunting rules here in India. Generally, we do scat analysis to study the feeding habits or the feeding ecology of any species. The difference between stomach analysis and the scat analysis is that stomach analysis is, of course, a very invasive method, and that needs the killing of a species. So in this study, since I've already mentioned that hunting was performed all around the year, so for collection of samples, we don't have to kill specifically for collection, we don't have to kill an individual. So hunters collect, hunters kill the species, and then they collect the stomach, and that comes to our university and preserved in the laboratory. So that's how we get the stomach analysis, stomach contents. And the other part is that in scat analysis, it's very difficult to collect the scats sometimes, especially in the monsoon season or in the wet seasons. And also there's a decomposition, there's a chance of decomposition. Whereas in stomach content analysis, you get the intact stomach and the contents can be exactly analyzed the way they were inside. With that, I'm not supporting stomach analysis for every species. Because it's a very invasive method, and in cases of endangered species or protected species, stomach analysis can never be an option. But whatever, with this study, this was very easy for us, and that's the reason why we chose it. So the stomach analysis was performed through wet techniques. The wet techniques refer to the fact that that at first the stomach is collected and defrosted, as I've already said, at minus 20 to minus 30 degrees centigrade inside the refrigerator. And this can be preserved since 10 to 20 years. So the samples which I have dissected were not very fresh samples, but were from 10 to 12 years back. And hence, it was very interesting to see that 10 or 12 years back, what the particular jackal species consumed. And similarly, you can also compare it to the recent stomachs and then and see that how the feeding habit changed throughout this all 10 or 12 years. So that's a very interesting part of it. And this wet technique of the stomach analysis was first described by Chirovich et al. 2014 and then by Lansky et al. 2015. So these are the primary basis of stomach analysis. I'll come to the part of how the stomach analysis has been done. So the analysis was basically performed in two ways. One is the macroscopic analysis and one is the microscopic analysis. So once the stomach is defrosted from the refrigerator and it is defrosted at room temperature, and then the weight of the particular stomach sample is recorded. I'll show you the picture. Yeah, this is the picture. So at first, this is how the stomach looks. So after defrost, we measured the stomach samples. You can see the weight of this is 188.7 grams, which is pretty much. This was of an adult jackal. And after the stomach thin is pretty, stomach skin is pretty thick. And after we dissect, like the second picture shows the dissection of the stomach skin. And after the stomach skin is dissected, the contents are kept in a particular petri dish, and again the stomach wall, this particular layer is measured again, and then it's subtracted from the original weight to get the exact weight of the contents. So these were some very diverse findings which I got. So the first one was this was one stomach full of beetles, and the time was the seasonal time was during June end. So for this particular sample, it's very clear that the jackal only consumed this whole lot of beetles. So as I've already said, it's a very opportunistic predator. That means wherever it gets that kind of food, whatever food is available, it just consumes. On the secondary, on the second picture, in the right side picture at the top, you can see that there's so much of grass. So that means maybe there was nothing more available at that particular place, so it consumed the grass. So for me, it was very surprising because I thought that maybe it always consumes a mixture of food items. But once I was dissecting, I found that whatever is available in whatever season, they just consume it. And on the third part, my hypothesis, as I've already explained, that the primary food sources of the jackal is small mammals or rodents, which already there are several studies conducted in India on jungle cats as well, which predicts that the small mammals, that jackals, that the jungle cats contribute a lot to the control of rats in fields. So this is very similar, because in one particular, all this, you can see how many moles are there, 8, 5, 9, and then there is maybe around 15. All of them were found from a particular stomach sample, so which was very surprising for me, because maybe at that particular point of time, a jackal found a rat hole, a mole hole, and it just ate whatever was available. So these are some of the findings. And this is the lab. That's how I work. The first picture at the left corner is a claw of a bird species. The second picture down, you can see there are some hairs. So this is the microscopic analysis which we do. I used to take the samples first and then dry them and then gradually segregate them each and every one by one, and then see through the microscope and try to figure out what kind of hair that is. So this hair is of wild boar's hair. So from the reference books which I've already mentioned before, there are the cross-sectional structure of every hair samples. So the deer hairs differ from the boar hairs, as well as from the small mammal hairs and so on. So that's how you compare with the cross-sectional view under the microscope and then realize from which species this particular hair is from. And on the right-hand side, in the at the top, you can see there are seeds. These are plum seeds. This was also at the end of spring, maybe in May end. So this from one stomach sample, there were this lot of plum seeds. That means the jackal ate a lot of fruits from wherever it found. And the next picture is of some leaves, dried leaves, and there's some small seed and some branches. So now coming to the part of the identification of species. So at first I told you about the macroscopic analysis. So when we wet, the stomach samples are analyzed through wet techniques, as I've already mentioned. So what we do is that after we wet the whole sample, we collect the contents in a particular sieve and wash it. So, and after the washing, whatever contents can be identified from the wet samples, we just segregate it in several petri dishes. And from that, we let it dry in room temperature. And maybe after, say, 12 hours and so on. And after that, we come back again and again try to do the microscopic analysis. The microscopic analysis of several hair samples, the bones, the feather, and other identifiable samples were done. And next, what the next part is the laboratory analysis, as I've already mentioned. So the microscopic analysis, there were 10 parts, 10 groups basically, with which the analysis has been done. The first one is the plant parts, the small mammals, the deer species, the wild boar, the insects, bird remains, domestic animals or livestock, the reptile species, unknown and identified, and the carrion consumption. So the tricky part of the study was the carrion consumption or the scavenging behavior. So the scavenging behavior of the jackals can be identified by the presence of maggots, because generally when something is decaying, there are the flies infest that particular rotten meat. And hence, a lot of maggots can be found from the stomach samples. And from that, if there were several occasions where I could find like the whole meat is full of maggots. And from that, it can be concluded that this particular meat comes from scavenging. And hence, that's the carrion consumption part of it. So this is the first. This is how the macroscopic analysis is converted into microscopic analysis. As you can see that the first parts are very simple, that's just the segregation part of it. And the second part is how the reorganization of the content classes were done on basis of microscopic analysis. So the plant parts were identified, plant species were also identified through the microscope and through reference books as well. The small mammals were identified from hairs, organs, meat, bones and nails. Bones and nails were also very important because reference classes were given in every in these two books that I've already mentioned, the Uiheli and Tering book. From there, the cross-sectional area, the structure of the teeth, the bones, the skin, all of this were done, and that way the presence of small mammals were identified. Similar with the deer species, the hair, organs, meat, skin, bones, nails, all of them were identified, especially the claws. And then from the wild boar also, similarly the hairs, mainly through hairs, because the deer hair and the wild boar hair are very different from each other. The insects are very easy to differentiate, and also the bird remains. From the bird remains, we can identify the exact species, the feather kind, the feather types, the claw types, the beak types, so that the exact bird species can be identified. Domestic or the livestock can be identified through maybe through hairs. For example, in one sample, I found a sheep hair. So the sheep hair is very different from that of a deer hair or a wild boar hair. So that's how, through microscopic analysis, this were done. Reptiles also, it was very surprising to see that the jackals consumed huge amount of reptiles, the European lizards, green lizards, and other species as well. So, and also the jackals consumed snakes, which is which was a very big surprise for me and my supervisor as well. So these were identified again through the scales for in case of reptiles. And unidentified or unknown were the ones which we could not identify at that particular moment of time. And the carrion consumption was through, again, through the presence of maggots, which I've already explained. So that's how the macroscopic analysis is converted to the microscopic analysis for the study. Now coming to the data analysis part of it. So broadly, there were two basic analyses. One is the percentage of frequency of occurrence and the percentage of biomass. The percentage of frequency of occurrence is that how many times a particular content is present compared to all the 40 samples which I've done. So from the formula, you can see that the number of occasions of a particular content found in a group divided by the total number of stomachs into 100. So for each and every particular stomachs, this kind of analysis was done to see how many times the jackal species preferred a particular kind of food item. And the other part is the percentage of biomass. Percentage of biomass is how much the mass or how much importance of the mass of the food item that the jackal is consuming. So the percentage of the biomass is described, the formula with which we have done. You can see that the mean or average of the particular content group from all the 40 stomachs divided by the mean or average of the total weight of the stomachs into 100. So that's how the percentage of frequency and the percentage of biomass was calculated to understand the ecology, the feeding ecology of the jackal. The statistical data was done through the presence and absence of prominent stomach categories, stomach contents. The prominent stomach contents were the big game species, which I've already said, that consisted the four main species, the red deer, roe deer, fallow deer, and the wild boar. And these were calculated through Fisher's exact 22 contingency tables, where two particular food items were compared with each other, and then the p-value is recorded. P is the significant to check whether there's a significant difference or not, and that's how they were compared and seen whether there's some really difference or not. And the second part is the seasonal data. The seasonal data was divided into winter, spring, and summer, autumn. And through genders, genders is through male and female during the pup rearing time, as well as during the normal time. Also in the winter, because in Hungary during the winters, it's very harsh. There are snow and hardly food sources are available. So this is also a very important part of the study. And also whether the big game species are the only consumed food sources or not. And lastly, the presence and absence data were statistically tested between three main categories. The first one is the rodents, the big game species, and the vegetative or the plant parts. So that's how the statistical analysis was done between mainly into three parts. And previously, as I've already said, as broadly as percentage of occurrence, frequency of occurrence, and the percentage of biomass. So these are a few of the results which I would like to explain. You can see that the comparison of the biomass percentage and the frequency of occurrence. So this is a very important part to understand that how many times a particular food item is preferred by a jackal compared to that, how much the food item is consumed by the jackal. So whether it is consuming a particular food item all the time or it's consuming a bit of it. So the percentage of biomass of plant parts, you can see, is only 5.77%. That means with every food item, the jackal is preferring to eat plant parts, but it's not consuming the whole of it. That means the frequency of occurrence is 77.5%. That means every time it's consuming plant parts with every meal. But the biomass percentage is only 5.77%. That means it does not constitute as a main or primary source of food item for the jackal. So compared to that, if we see the deer species, then the biomass percentage is 21.74%, which is fairly high. That means whenever the jackal is preferring to eat a deer species, it's eating a lot of meat. So that means that, and if you compare with that of the frequency of occurrence, which is only 47.7%, and if you compare that with the plant pulse, it is 77.5 and 47.7%. That means it's not eating the deer species all the time as frequent as the plant parts. The reason is because it's not available, of course. But whenever it's eating, it's always trying to eat most of it. That defines the part that a jackal is a mesocarnivore. Otherwise, it can be called as an omnivore, but that's not true. It is an omnivore, but primarily a carnivore. Similar with, if we come to the rodents part, you can see that the frequency of occurrence is 52%. That means half the time they are consuming rodents, whereas the biomass percentage is 15.84%, which is much lower than that of the deer species. So it's eating, the jackal prefers to have the small mammals or the small rodents in most of the time, but the biomass percentage is smaller. The reason is because the biomass is smaller compared to deers as well. So this is the bit of calculation, how I have done the percentage of biomass, frequency of occurrence compared to the standard deviation as well. I'll not go into the details of it. These are the feeding habits of the presence and absence analysis of big game species. You can see this is done through the Fisher's exact test of 22 contingency table, the seasonal data, winter, spring, summer, autumn, gender-based data, male, female, and big game as the only source of food items. The p-value was not much. It was not significant. The p-value is considered significant when the value is 0.005, less than 0.005, but here it's much more than that. That means there is no significant differences found between this data. The reason, as I've already said, that there's a high spatiotemporal variability of the data. Maybe that is the reason why this could not be found. Similar with the presence data for the big games and rodent species, the big game and the vegetative plants, and rodents and the vegetative plant parts. So these three food items, main three food items, were compared between each other with the average stomach size. The average stomach size was found to be around 73.3 grams. And based on that, the smaller or bigger stomach sizes were differentiated. And the p-value was also not significant in this case as well. So the results continued that there were no significant differences found between the presence absence data of big game species in the study, as I've already said, and between the genders also there were no gender specific differences in the data. Statistically significant differences were also not found between these three food categories, which I have already said, and this is the reason behind can be the high spatiotemporal variability. So now coming to some unusual findings of the study, from one of the stomach samples which was collected from the valence slit, which I have showed you before, the hatchlings of European pond turtle, Emys orbicularis, were found. So these were not even born. These are, you can see the umbilical cord is attached to the wall of the egg. That means it's not even hatched. So five such samples were found from one of the stomachs. That means this species is nationally protected in Hungary. And the consumption of this species is a huge threat to the nature conservation of the European pond turtle. And hence, you can see I tried to show you that how the feeding habits, the feeding ecology differed from starting from fruits to moles to seeds and now to pond turtle hatchlings, which is a very surprising and interesting fact as well, because turtles often lay their eggs deep inside burrow and then cover it. So it's interesting how the jackal tried to burrow, open the burrow and find out the eggs and just consumed it before maybe these hatched. And also another stomach sample, I could find the upper jaw and the nasal part of red fox. Red fox is also a canid species, which inhibit the same territory as the golden jackal. You can see the upper nasal part of the red fox pup. This is a red fox pup. That means that either this can be through predation or maybe this can be through interspecific competition between the two species. You can still see the milk teeth from the inner part of the jaw. Now coming to the conclusion of the study, so the hypothesis was that the jackals' primary food sources were small rodents and mammals, compared to the percentage of biomass and frequency of occurrence. It is very evident that this hypothesis is proof, because most of the time the jackals preferred to consume the small mammals. And similar to that, the percentage of biomass is also 15.84%, which is pretty much. So this hypothesis was proved from the study. Coming to the goals and objectives, to obtain a comprehensive study, comprehensive knowledge about the overall diet, which was done from 2003 to 2014. It was comprehensively done, and all the samples which you have seen, which I've tried to show the picture of them, not all of them, but some of them, can easily predict the feeding ecology of the jackals in Hungary. To obtain the seasonal variation and just in the seasonal and gender diet preferences, as I've already said that there were no statistical differences found, but on one occasion, the insect consumption varied from autumn, summer, and in winter, there were nothing, winter and spring. So from this, it can be clear that the insects don't come out during the winter and spring in Europe because it's really cold. And that's the reason why there was no frequency of occurrence of the insects in the stomach samples. The third one was to obtain the consumption, knowledge about the consumption of big game species by the golden jackals. Big game species was fairly near to the small rodents, but the fact that there were a lot of maggots found in the carrion, in the meat, inside the meat of the consumed materials, it can be predicted that the jackal is a scavenger, and most of the time it depended on carrion consumption for its survival. The fourth one was to obtain knowledge about the carrion consumption, which I've already said. So there were lots, most of the time there were maggots inside the stomach contents, and the frequency of occurrence was found to be 45%, which is pretty much. So hence it can be concluded that it's an opportunistic and scavenging species. So thus to conclude, the primary sources were, sources of food were small mammals, rodents, deer species, and carrion consumption. The secondary sources were insects, plants, parts, fruits, and seeds. And the tertiary or the opportunistic food items were reptiles and livestock. Hence, from this study, it is very clear that the opportunistic and largely adaptive feeding behavior of the golden jackal is the only reason why it spreads its territory throughout this part of several parts of Europe. So with that, I'll end my presentation. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much, Ms. Shreya Bhattacharya, ma'am, for your fantastic and detailed talk about the feeding ecology of golden jackals. Now we have learned a lot of things in this regard. And with due permission from both the speakers, we would wish to continue our interactive session now. So we have a lot of questions in the chat box now, and it is good to see that some of the questions are already being addressed by Ms. Sudha already. So if I repeat those questions, I would like to request Ms. Sudha to remind me that those are addressed already. So the first, most of the questions are answered already. I would like Ms. Gitashree Paul wants to know that she asks, I would like to ask how the wildlife refuges are different from our wildlife sanctuaries. This is a question for Sudha.
I could tell you that they're pretty similar. Wildlife refuges are actually here, we don't have patrolling in wildlife refuges. The main difference here is that the national parks and wildlife sanctuaries have a strong forest force in their areas, and they patrol it regularly. In US, we don't patrol our wildlife refuges, we just patrol our national parks. So that is one of the main differences. Wildlife refuges is actually used for more like, most people don't really use them for, they don't even go into those refuges because they know it is for conservation. And there's hefty fines if they catch you in there. So most people don't actually go near those refuges. So I haven't heard a case yet. Most people use the national park to go hiking, trekking, or things of that nature. But only on hiking routes, only on certain routes are you able to go. Anywhere you veer off, you have to pay a fine. So these are highly enforced in the U.S. So basically, I would say that the people don't go near the parks where they're not supposed to. Or even the refuges. And that is the main difference. Our populations aren't even located near these areas. So these places like Yellowstone National Park or even the Florida Panther Wildlife Refuge, these are pretty isolated areas. There will be nobody in there unless they're doing some mischievous things. And in that case, there are heavy fines and they go to prison. And that is a really... not good for their part. So these are pretty enforced. So those are the main differences.
Okay, thank you. The next question is from Poonam Sarkar. She asked, what is the potential impact on polar bears of oil exploration and extraction?
You're asking me about polar bears and how they relate to oil extraction?
Exactly. What is the potential impact of that?
Impact. Okay. So Alaska is pretty remarkable area. It is a wild wilderness, untouched, which you can't say much in the U.S. On the East Coast, we have a lot of secondary forests. On the West Coast, you have some wilderness, but Alaska is pretty much the last wilderness that you will find. So in this area, we all conservationists want to preserve this area. And there is also a lot of oil in this area because it's the Arctic. And there's a lot of drilling and gas pipelines and all such things. So when people are doing gas drilling or oil drilling, they will take these heavy equipment and then they'll go there, put a station there, and then they'll drill holes underneath the ground to catch the oil because the oil and gas is down there. So this disrupts like the fish ecosystems, this disrupts the seals. So it also makes the sound in the water. And you know from physics that the sound gets amplified in water, right? So all such things are happening and marine mammals are also affected by these oil drillings. So in past administrations, they have limited oil drilling and gas drilling in Alaska. However, the last administration didn't do that. So they have a negative impact on marine mammals as well as polar bears, as well as seals, because if they're impacting seals, they're impacting polar bears because polar bears eat the seals, right? So these are having cascade impacts. So oil drilling is pretty contentious because people want jobs, but there, it's also bad for the environment. So these are some of the struggles that we have to do in the U.S. Fish and Wildlife. We have to balance these kinds of issues, so to speak.
Okay, thank you. The next question is from Eliza Basumatari. She is a PhD research scholar of Borolian University. She actually has asked three questions. I will ask you all at a time now. The first question is, ma'am, please inform the distribution of Florida panther. The second one is, what are the causes of genetic depletion of Florida panthera? And the third one is, what favored tigers to be more in population in a country like India?
Okay, I'll take one question at a time.
sure, you can. The first one is that, ma'am, please inform about the distribution of Florida panther.
The distribution of current Florida panther is just isolated to South Florida.
Okay. But the second one is, what are the causes of genetic depletion of Florida panther?
It is actually, like I said, the causes of genetic isolation is probably because there are vehicle collisions, hunting, like the Florida panther has been depleting for a long time, and then it has been isolated to certain pockets. So this is causing interbreeding, and it also caused population declines. So that's why the Florida panther, as opposed to the Texas panther, puma, is doing much worse So that is why they wanted to intermingle the repopulate the Florida panther with the Texas puma. So before the Florida panther was stretched all the way to Louisiana and Arkansas. Now it is only isolated to South Florida, and this is largely due to development, largely due to habitat destruction, hunting, vehicle collisions. So all such things were happening, and that is causing the Florida panther to be isolated and causing genetic depletion.
Okay. The third part of the question says that she wants to know what favored tigers to be more in population in a country like India.
It's possible. I can say you can definitely have more tigers in Manas. I mean, there's only 46 tigers right now, and you have 900 square kilometers. But as opposed to Kaziranga, Manas doesn't have the prey base as much as Kaziranga. So you have to have the prey base in order to have tigers. So anywhere you have a good prey base and you have good habitat, you will have a lot of tigers, because the tigers is highly correlated with prey base. I would say Manas can have as many, if not more, tigers because of just the square kilometers. 900 square kilometers versus 420, I believe, in Kaziranga. So Manas is capable of having more tigers just in Assam itself. So that's it, I think. Did I answer that question?
Okay, now Kaziranga has more area.
But it has more tigers because Kaziranga has more prey base, better prey base. I think that is the truth. That is my estimate. I'm not a deer expert, obviously, but in Kaziranga you have a large prey base. You have four types of deer, right? In Manas, the swamp deer went extinct during the 90s, during the insurgency of the. There was a lot of and tigers also went extinct. Rhinos went extinct during the insurgency. So Manas has a different history, but it's not so much. There are animals they can breed, and if you have the right conditions, they'll come back. So that is how we feel in the U.S. If you have the right conditions, you can pretty much have good wildlife conservation.
Okay, thank you. So the next question is for Shreya ma'am. This one is from a prominent person himself, Professor Hilaljyoti Sinha sir. He is the HOD of Zoology, Boroland University. He asked, Shreya, how about the Alipur population of jackal? I have, and he says that I had seen a presentation about this long ago.
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
Sir asked, how about the Alipur population of jackal?
Alipur?
Yeah.
I'm not exactly sure, but I think that it's available. It's widely distributed in several parts of India. So I am not exactly aware of the population.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Now continuing to the next question, we have for Sudha. If I am not wrong, this question is from Dr. Dilip Bora sir. He is a faculty of zoology, CNB College. Sir asked to Sudha that regarding the human wildlife conflict, how can we minimize the human leopard conflict from human proximity?
The question is regarding, can you repeat the question? I'm sorry.
The question to be exact is, how can we minimize the human leopard conflict from human proximity?
Human proximity. I think, how can we minimize human tiger conflict, human leopard conflict? Same way we minimize minimize any human wildlife conflict is through awareness. through, so in for tiger and human conflict, they have these, the government has a scheme where if the tiger eats your cattle, the government can reimburse you. We can do the same thing with leopard. I think the government does that already. So also you can have government support, awareness programs. I think that is the best way, actually. And also to most people I have interviewed, they want like a fence to keep the wildlife from coming into their villages. So maybe erecting a fence maybe would also be helpful for the villagers or minimize human leopard conflict.
Okay, thank you. The next one is from Digbizar Hendik. He asked Shreya ma'am, are stomach analysis done periodically over species to notice changes or concluded after some tries?
If you talk about the golden jackals, those are hunted throughout the year. Hence, the stomachs are collected and preserved in the refrigerator and can be analyzed anytime. So if we take a particular time sample, for example, say 5 years to 10 years, and that's how the comparative data analysis can be done. So with this particular species, it can be collected. The collection process is done throughout the year. So there is no such thing as over a particular time period.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. The next one is from Poonam Sarkar. She asks, how, Shreya ma'am, oh, hello, Shreya ma'am, after every 12 years, this stomach analysis is done. And is it only done to see what the jackal eat or are there some other reasons to do this?
Basically, this is done because every 10 years, the landscape changes. As is happening everywhere, the habitats disappear and there are constructions that take place. So how the feeding analysis changed, how the feeding patterns change, and how the particular species adapt to the changing habitats. So this is one of the reasons. And also, as I've already explained, that the presence of big game species, which is a threat to the stakeholders in Hungary, that is also one of the reasons why they do the stomach analysis.
The next question says asked from Bangkul Burman. He asks, Shreya ma'am, is golden jackal available in Assam?
I'm sure it is. It's widely distributed all across India, so I'm sure.
Okay, the next question is for Sudha. Vishal Gautam asks, my question is, what are the difference in the policy making between Government of India and Government of USA for wildlife conservation? And he also has a second question. The second question is, what are the most necessary things to be made in the policies for wild animal species conservation in India?
So the first question regarding what are the differences between policy making is that in the US, the people petition the government to list a endangered species. So anybody in the US, any citizen can petition the government, the Fish and Wildlife Service, to list a species. And the species is listed under 5 factors. So I think I covered this in my previous lecture. So the main difference is that here in India, I believe the government decides with the scientists. So, which is a different process. So that is the main difference between policy making as it relates to listing endangered species. Can you repeat the second part of the question, Keshav?
Okay, sure. The second question says, what are the most necessary changes to be made in the policies for wild animal species conservation in India?
That is really up to your government. I think there needs to, any changes to policy, any changes to India, that has to come from the people itself. It cannot come from scientists or Westerners or even me. So I would say study up on the policy and figure out what are the gaps and petition your government, because it is not a good idea for foreigners to tell a different country what to do. That's not what scientists do either. So for my country, I can say that for sure that In order to improve the listing process, I would have the government be list species. For now, it takes about 15 years to list a species on the endangered species list. So I would say you have to be a little more efficient than that. So, and then also transparency is important within the Fish and Wildlife Service, because we do some amazing good work, but the public has no idea what we're doing. So we also have to be transparent about what we're doing and how thorough we are. So they're not taking 15 years just so they can just put all the endangered species under a folder and just sitting there. They're actually doing a lot of good work. They're using the best available science. I know this because I used to work there. So we also have to be transparent about what we're doing. So as it relates to US, I can tell you a lot of things we can do that can help expedite wildlife conservation. But for India, I think the Indians have to figure out what they want and petition their government. That's all.
Okay, so we have a lot of questions actually, and it is not actually possible to address all of them, but we can request both of our respective resource persons to leave their if they allow us, they can leave their email IDs in the chat box so that people may contact you if they want to know more from you. So coming to the next part, we can take one more question. Now we have time for one more question. The last question will be from Deepanjana. The question is, Shreya ma'am, are male jackals food preferences different from female ones, or as well as young ones, as well as in young jackals too? Also, is there any difference in consuming food type during day and night?
Yeah, actually, that's a very good question. For male jackals, the adult males, the food preferences are mostly meat. The reason is because generally, as we know, that the jackals live in groups, and the dominant or the alpha males always have consumed the most of the food items. Hence, from the stomach samples, it is clear that in adult males, there are most of the time, there are a lot of meat sources. But in case of juvenile adults or the females, the amount is less. And that is substituted through other things like the plant species or the fruit species. So hence, yes, being the dominant, the adult males which are dominant, the food preferences are, the stomach samples are different compared to the juveniles of ones or the female ones. And in case of the feeding ecology of the female jackals, during the pup rearing season, the preferences shift from only one kind of food sources to a variety of food sources. I think that is due to the fact that a lot of nutrients are required during the pup rearing season, and hence this was found. What was the second part of the question?
Ma'am, the second part of the question is also, is there any difference in consuming food type during day and night?
Okay, during day and night, yes. At night, most of the times there were conditions where the jackals preferred to eat moles, because the moles don't come out, the rodents don't tend to come out during the daylight. So yeah, that can be one of the differences, that during the daytimes they tend to consume more of the plant sources, and at night more of rodent species. So that's what I found from my sample.
Okay, thank you once again, both the respected persons. Actually, due to time constraint, we are about to move to the next agenda. But it's very good to know that we have a lot of questions left behind, and participants can interact with the persons. We will provide you with the email IDs of the respected persons, resource persons. So, moving on to the next agenda. May I now request our Honorable President Sir of Zoological Society of Assam, Shri Priyaboto Lohkor Sir, who has been with us right from the beginning in all the steps that we have taken. We would like to request Sir to express a few words on this occasion, Sir. Over to you.
Thank you, Keshav. Thank you, Sudha, and thank you, Shreya. Both are now associated with particularly Sudai associated with Assam biology, Assam wildlife. She is associated with Assam Wildlife and doing a lot of works on it. Now, after going through or listening to all of or both of you, one thing comes to my mind that should there be a course, special course of wildlife management at the undergraduate level? If it is there, I don't know. I don't know whether in Guwahati University or in Dibrugarh University or in another university, there is a course like that, the wildlife management in undergraduate level. Now, if it is there, we can take up that matter with some of the universities so that we can do a lot of work. And one thing this Rhea or Sudha has said, the landscape is changing every 10 years. Is it correct? The landscape is changing every 10 years and the habitat is also changing like that. And the wild animals living there tend to change their food habit and other things. And how much it is correct, I don't know. It may be correct or not. Anyway, listening to you, I'm really happy to learn about more about the wildlife management and the wildlife in USA, as well as in Hungary and in India, and particularly in Assam. I'm thankful to the authority, particularly the principal doctor of CND College and other persons concerning organizing this webinar for the benefit of our students. I'm more thankful to our innovator, Professor Jugan Korita, as well as our working president, Dr. Bolando Kumar Das, so that they are taking much interest in developing the nature and habit of the students, particularly the undergraduate level. They are now taking more care about the undergraduate level so that they can come in the next 2 to 3 years in the more research-oriented work or more study work. Yes, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Thank you all for organizing such a nice and very interesting topic. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Lokar, sir. Thank you, Keshav Jyoti Bora. I also thank to our Subha and Shreya ma'am, and I'm very much thankful to the participants who have taken part in interactive session, especially our SS second year student Unam Sarkar and BSc second semester physics student Dick Vijay Handikoi. Now may I request our working president, Dr. Balendra Kumar Das sir, to pay his few words about the webinar.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. Respected Principal Surajit Dotto of CNB College, Bokakhat. Respected President of Geological Society of Assam, Priyabroto Lohkar sir. Our ever energetic General Secretary and presently HOD of Guwahati University Geology Department, Professor Jugan Chandra Kolita. Today's center of attraction, Sudha Balajapali and Shreya Vattacharji. My dear participants, all the respected faculty members from CNB College Bokakhat and others, we also had today this evening HOD of Geology from Borland University, Professor Hillul Jyoti Sinha. We are having lots of people from different parts of the globe who has participated today and made this webinar a successful one. I'm so glad to hear from both the speakers that they had done their studies in depth and it has opened a new avenue for all the researchers and our undergraduate students. And it has been a percolation of thought to their mind that yes, we need research, we need wildlife, and we need wildlife studies and management, and we need the case studies for a better world. Because it has been seen from Sudha's deliberation that there are 4 or 5 things which is very essential and it should be properly managed, like wildlife habitat, populations of the wildlife, associated recreational activities and values. In our country, we have seen when these two young scientists, young researchers were presenting their papers, from the questions of the young people, students and researchers, it has become very evident that the basic question for India is the population explosion, human population explosion, and it is not that wildlife is encroaching our habitat, but we the people, we are encroaching their habitat. So it is of this region, particularly of the northeastern region and whole of India, that yes, we have to leave the habitat of the wildlife populations, and it has become very evident with the example of killing 18 elephants in Kondoli Pahar near Nogaon, that there is a question mark. It has been reported from the study that it has been killed by lightning. But friends, it is a very evident question for all wildlife lovers, researchers, and students and faculty members, that still there are question marks whether the elephants in one stroke killed by the lightning. We know there are different examples all over the world. Even in Colorado, there were 312 deer killed by this electrocution of lightning. But we are not sure whether these elephants were killed like that. So that is also a matter of research for our young scientists and young students. Today, one of our student friends, he has put one question up that Edward O. Wilson's book, Harvard. I'm lucky that I had gone through that book, and he has opined, his view was like, we have to preserve half of the land and sea for the wild animal. This is a question for the whole world community, whether we should or we shouldn't. But the fact is that yes, you have to ponder over this question of E.O. Edward, whether we should think about preserving half of the global area of land and sea for wild habitat or not. I'm very happy that I'm having a connection with Shreya Bhattacharjee. She was in agriculture, Hungarian University of Agriculture and Life Sciences. And I was there long back in 1988, presented a paper in Budapest, and I visited Godolu, the place where the headquarter of this Hungarian University of Agriculture and Life Sciences are there. And I did visit the Lake Balaton, where I found many species. Yeah, Lake Balaton. So with that connection, I can say that yes, in Hungary, as our president sir has put it, that every 10 to 12 years, landscape is changing. Yes, because the European countries are having very small land areas, and they are like a bigger district of Assam only. So in Hungary also might be there is landscape changing every 10 years. And that's why they are supposed to go for resources of this kind. Anyway, I won't take long time from all of you. Let us pray. Let us walk. Let us go for serious research work so that we can heal the world. Thank you very much. Thanks to everyone. And thanks specially to CNB College for giving me this opportunity to express my views. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, sir, for your so informative speech. Now may I request
Thank you.
Professor Pathankar Chaudhary, sir, from Assam University, Silchar. And I request him to pay a few words in this webinar. Pathankar Chaudhary, sir, from Assam University, Silchar.
Maybe he is not present. I saw him but at this moment he may not be there.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
I saw him joining and I saw him leaving.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, then next I request Professor Hilaljyoti Sinha sir from Borgen University to pay a few words for us and encourage our students. Professor
Hilaljyoti
Sinha, sir.
I have seen Professor Hilaljyoti Sinha. He has also left with a message, of course.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir. So it is the time for vote of thanks. Now I request Dr. Madhulika Datta, Assistant Coordinator, IQSC CNB College, for vote of thanks.
Thank you, Vidur Vikas Swaka, sir. Good evening to all. It's an honor to have been asked to offer a vote of thanks on the occasion of this wonderful webinar organized by Zoological Society of Assam and CNB College, Bokakhat. On behalf of the CNB College family, I express my hearty gratitude to Sri Priyabha Lahkar sir, President, Zoological Society of Assam, Dr. Balendra Kumar Das sir, Working President, Zoological Society of Assam, for their valuable advices in organizing this webinar. I want to extend my generous thanks to Professor Jogan Chandra Kalita sir, Head of the Department of Geology, Guwahati University, and General Secretary, Zoological Society of Assam, without whom we would not be able to organize this webinar in Chasi way. With the CNB family, always grateful to him for his valuable advices and inspiration in every step of the development of our college. I, on behalf of CNB College, express my warm gratitude to our honorable guest, Sudha Balajapalli ma'am from George Mason University, USA, and Shreya Bhattacharya ma'am from IUCN SSC Monitor Lizard Specialist Group for their excellent presentations and for sharing their vast knowledge with us. I think all the participants of this webinar are highly inspired by your highly sparkling words. I also want to take the opportunity to express my gratefulness to Dr. Jyotismita Das ma'am, Assistant Professor, Department of Geology, Nagpur College, Autonomous, Mr. Keshav Jyoti Bora, Research Scholar, Department of Geology, Guwahati University, Mr. Hirak Jyoti Bharali, Mr. Juganta Jyoti Das, and Ms. Shankranti Devi, Geology Lab, Geology Account, for their kind permission during the course of the time of this webinar. I may like to express my sincere thanks to our principal, Dr. Surajit Dutta sir, IQSC coordinator, Bedrock Vikas Soikia sir, for their kind effort in organizing this webinar. In such a short time, you have made the best arrangement of this program. Last but not the least, I, on behalf of the CNB team, express my thanks to all the teaching and non-teaching staff, all the participants, including students, for their active involvement in the entire program. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, madam. Thank you for your vote of thanks. Now I request Keshav Jyoti Bora to provide the feedback link on the sub box. And now we are going to...
Yes, sir. It has been provided.
Yes. Now we are going to present Assam State Anthem, Omur Apunar Dekh. After that, our JSA General Secretary, Professor Jogan Chandra Kalita sir, will declare the closing of the webinar. Now we are going to present the Assam anthem, and during this time, I request all to mute their phones.
বিদ্যুত মই সাউন্ডটো নাই পোৱা
Okay, sir, due to some practical problem, so audio is not performing. So I request to declare the webinar, sir.
Okay. So thank you so much, especially both the speakers. I was so happy to see their confidence and the knowledge, level of knowledge and the confidence at this very young age. And I'm very happy to listen to all the speakers, right from our principal who gave the welcome address, the vote of thanks, Bolenda, our president of Geological Society of Assam, and all wonderful questions put by the wonderful people and also answered by our, the resource persons. And I am very happy that our president of the district already mentioned about the wildlife management course in the colleges. And I wish that CA should be the first college in this part of India to develop this management course, wildlife management course in undergraduate level. And I know that our working president, Bolendra Kumar Das sir, our president, Priyavrata Lahkar sir, and both the resource persons today, Da and Shreya, will be able to help us. And I am sure Professor Parthankar Chowdhury from Assam University and our Hiralojyoti Sinha, Professor and Head of Borland University, and Professor Prashant Kumar Shaikia, Head of the former Head of Zoology Department and Wildlife Expert, and also Vibhav Talukdar will be helping us. So thank you very much, and I declare, with great pleasure, I declare this event
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Sneha.
Thank you, sir.